So, welcome everybody to this talk on action of the Cremona Group on the CAP0 Cube Complex. Before starting, I would like to thank the organizer of the Virtual Geometry Group Theory Conference to have invited me to give this talk. And I would like also to thank Guillaume Menenfert for the technical help support. So I will present a work which is joint with Christian Ourer. And we are interested in the Cremona Group. So first of all, I will define the notion I need to construct this complex. So this group is coming from algebraic geometry. So I will recall some notions. So for the one which are used with algebraic geometry, when I will speak about surface, it will be regular surface over any field and projective surface, sorry. For the one who doesn't understand what I mean, I just mean projective surface which are smooth, so without singularities, and you can take the field that will be the complex number, and it will be okay. So a birational transformation between two surfaces is an isomorphism between two open dense subsets. So this is for the Zariski topology, so we are allowed to remove zero locus of polynomials. So in the case of surfaces, we will be allowed to remove points and the curve. Well, and contract curve, sorry. Why are we interested in birational transformation? Is because in algebraic geometry, classifying a variety up to isomorphism gives too many classes. It's really too rigid for this notion. And so the good notion to classify them is up to birational transformation. So these maps are really important in algebraic geometry. And one, we will focus a lot on it, and we'll see it all during the talk. It will be the notion of blow up. So we blow up a point P in a surface S prime. It means that we have a morphism, so in a map which is well defined from the surface S to the surface S prime, and it contracts the more dark line, which is isomorphic to P1, it contracted to the point P, and outside this point P and this line, which is isomorphic to P1, it's an isomorphism. And we said that the point P has been blown up, and what we get, this line we get here, is called the exceptional divisor. And what happens is that when we do this, if you take two lines down which cross on P, they will be separated above. So in fact, any point on this exceptional divisor gives the direction of a line down. When we fix a surface S, we can look at its group of birational transformation. And the Cremona group is when the surface fixed is a projective plane. As the name suggests, is Luigi Cremona which has introduced this group. And it has been studied from many, many points of view. So of course, from an algebraical point of view, but also the dynamic of its map has been studied. It has been studied also its topology, and also from a geometric point of view. In fact, since the year 2008-10, this group has been constructed an action of this group on a geometric space, on a hyperbolic space, and a lot of results has been done using this action. Like for instance, that it's not a simple group, and that it satisfied alternative logics, and so on. But the aim of this talk, and also that the work with Christian, is to construct an action of the Cremona group on a K0 cube complex. So first of all, it will give a new geometric space for the Cremona group, and we'll see that it's really a natural way to construct it, and that we unified a lot of results which we already knew, and also it will extend them to any field. And what we had in mind when we started this project was also to construct then, if this was working well, K0 cube complexes for a Cremona group of higher rank. So when we look at birational transformation of projective space, not just a projective plane. And so this was the second part of article, but now I will focus only on the first part. So construct a K0 cube complex for the Cremona group of rank 2. for those who, well, where it's the first time we saw this group. So a birational transformation, we can write it explicitly from the projective space, of the projective plane, pardon, sorry. So for x, y, z, you associated three homogeneous polynomials of the same degree and without common factor. So this is a rational map. And if you want it to be rational, you need to also say that it has an inverse of the same form. And we ask that the polynomials are homogeneous and of the same degree in order that this map is well defined on P2. And we want that it's of common without common factor, like, because if it will be with common factor, you can cancel it. And once we have done this, the degree will be well defined and it will be the degree of the Fi. And here is, there is a dash arrow. And this is because there are points where F is not well defined and they are exactly the one where the polynomial F0, F1, and F2 vanishes simultaneously. So it will be sent to 0, 0, and it's not allowed. So I will give some examples. So here I recall what I said in the slide before. So the first subgroup of the Cremona group is a group of automorphism of P2. So when the map is well defined and the inverse is also well defined everywhere. And these are the map of degree one, so it means that all the factors are linear, all the polynomials are linear, and because we ask that it has an inverse, and it's about, and it's on the projective space, it's PGL, it's isomorphic to PGL3. Now, an important, so this is a subgroup of the Cremona group, and another important Cremona transformation is a standard quadratic involution, sigma. And we'll, well, all my example will take sigma any time, so be focused on the definition. So to x, y, z, it sends to y, z, x, z, and x, y. So it's of degree two. If you look at the, in a affine chart, so you divide by the last coordinate and you put z equals to one, it sends x, y to one over x, one over y. So it's clear that it's an involution. And if we took two of the three coordinates to be zero, so which correspond to these three points here, then it sends to 0, 0, 0. So there are three points which are not well defined for the application sigma. And if you look at the line yellow, for instance, which is of equation x equals zero, then the image will be something here, 0, 0. So it will be sent to the point 1, 0, 0, which is this point. So this yellow line is contracted by sigma to this yellow point, the orange line to the orange point, and the red line to the red point. And because it's an involution, it's the same for sigma minus one. And what we see is that except these three lines, which are contracted, and these three points, which are not well defined, it's an isomorphism outside this three line. And these three lines are zero. Now we go on important theorem for surfaces, which is the Zariski theorem. And it explains why BOAP are really important. It says that if we have a birational transformation between surfaces, then we can find the surface W and two compositions of BOAPs, P1 and P2, such that this diagram commutes. And what it says that in fact you can decompose F as a composition of BOAP end of blowdown, okay, or inverse of blow up. And this is called the resolution of F, and we can decide to choose a minimal one by saying that we can take W minimal, which means that if you have another W prime with two other compositions of blow ups, P1 prime and P2 prime, then we'll have such a diagram. Here the arrow is full. It means that in this way is well defined. So it means that it can contract things, but it cannot blow up things. And in fact, W prime will be obtained by blowing up points from W. So, and it means that in fact we have done too many things. Well, we have blow up points that we have to contract it again. So we have done some things which are not necessary. So let's say how this theorem works with our favorite map, which is sigma. So this is, okay, is a sigma we have seen before, where yellow is the three lines here are contracted to these three points. And these are the three points which are not well defined. So what we want is that we want to do composition of go up to arrive here and blow down. So first of all, we can go up this point. We obtain here a surface, and we have seen that this point is replaced by P1, by the exceptional divisor, and that the lines which were crossing in P, they are separated here. And this line will correspond to this line here, between the yellow and the red. And now if we compose sigma with this blow up, with this blow up map, there are still two points which are not well defined, because P change things above the point 010, but then outside it's an isomorphism, so we didn't change anything outside. So this composition is not well defined, so there are still two points which are not well defined. So we can continue to blow up and blow up, for instance, these points. We arrive to this surface. Now, this point is again not well defined for the composition of sigma with these two blow up. And we can blow up it again. And then we arrive to a surface where now the composition between sigma and these three blow up is well defined. And we see that to this map, in fact, what it does, it contracts this orange line to this point, it contracts this red line to this point, and it contracts this line to this point. So in fact, we have decomposed sigma with three blow up, and okay, here I didn't do the intermediate step, but it will be also three inverse of blow up. And so if we come back to this theorem, it allows to define what is called the base point of F. They are the points which are blow up in the minimal resolution of F on this side by P1. So here the base point of sigma was the point 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, and 0, 1, 0. Pay attention that I did an example, and not any base points, they lie in the surface S, or in the case of what is before in P2. For instance, if we look at this map from P2 to P2, the only point which is not well defined is the point where is when Z is 0, then we have 0 here and 0 here, and X equals 0. So the point 0, 1, 0 is not a point which is well defined, and it's the only one which lies in P2. So if we come back here with drawing, but it's not the one of sigma, not the one I speak about. Only this one is not well defined for the application I gave just before. So when we blow up this this point, we get a P1. And in fact, if you look at the composition, it will be a new point on this line, which will be not defined for the composition. And this point, which will be not defined for the composition, is also called a blow up of the point. And the notion of blow-up will be primordial for the construction of, for the consequence of the cube complex. So now we can construct our cube complex. First of all, we want to define vertices. There will be an equivalence class of marked surfaces. What I mean by this is that S is a rational surface, which means that it's birational to P2. P is a birational map from S P2. It exists because S is rational. And the equivalence class is given by the fact that we want that the marking, when we compose them, it does an isomorphism. So what we want exactly is that phi prime minus 1 phi, which would be the map which respects the marking, which goes from S to S prime, we want that this is an isomorphism. So everything we'll do will be up to isomorphism of the surface we are looking for. And we put an edge between two vertices if we have two representatives like this, and such that psi minus 1 phi is the blow up or the inverse of a blow up of a point. Okay, so this elementary maps will be in fact our edges. So now we do an example. If we look at two points in P2 and one which is on the exceptional divisor of Q, so I repeat, when we have blown up the point Q, it appears an exceptional divisor isomorphic to P1, and we have a point on it, which were not in P2 before. So So this is a blow-up of the point P, so there is an edge. This is a blow-up of the point Q, there is an edge. And once we have Q, we can also blow up the point Q prime, and this will give you another edge. But attention, this surface here, well, from this surface here and this surface here, we cannot blow up the point Q prime. To see the point Q prime appear, we have to first blow up Q. Now, once we are here, okay, here we have the point P and Q in P2. So here it's an isomorphism outside the point P and the exceptional divisor EP. So we have the image of Q somewhere. And we can decide to blow up this point, and it will give us a new vertex. But if we go here and we blow up the image of P, it will give the same vertex. It will give the same vertex. So this gives us vertex. And of course, what we want to do is that here we see a square and we have a cube complex. And what we want to do is that we want to fill this square. And so our definition of a square will be if we have two distinct points on a surface, then if doing one point or doing the other points give you a square, because then the order doesn't matter. Now here we have a third point, so we could think that we could have a cube, but because this third point doesn't belong to P2, we don't have a cube, but it will generate two squares. Okay, so we will have a square here, and once we are on this surface F1, we can either blow up the point P, or we can either blow up the point Q prime, and it gives you another, gives us a new square. Now we go to the definition of a cube. So n cube is given by 2 to the power n vertices, and such that there exists representative of this form. And we have a surface SR containing n distinct points, and all the other vertex will be obtained by blowing up in all the possible ways a subset of this point. So, say it correctly, it means that the marquage will satisfy phi r minus 1 of phi g is the blow-up of a subset of the points p1 into pn. And any of this blowing up of this subset will give a vertex. So here, if we have p2 identity, we have three points in p2. Blowing up p, q, or r gives you this vertex. If we blow up two points, it gives this, this, and this vertices. And if we blow up three points, it will give us this vertex. So some remarks about this Q complex. First of all, it's not locally compact, because when we are on P2, we can blow up all the points of P2, which are infinite. So this gives us infinitely many edges. So it's not locally compact. And it's even not of a finite dimension, because each time you take a subset of these points, they generate a cube. So you can have a cube of dimension as big as you want. But what it saves us a bit to get the result is that this cube complex is oriented. So two vertex which aren't by an edge, we can give an orientation if phi prime minus one phi is the blow-up of a point S prime. And so we know that it's an edge if this is a blow-up or the inverse of a blow-up. And when we go in the direction of this is a blow-up, it means that this one will be oriented from this one to this one. And so we can have an 8 on the cube complex, and we'll say that the 8 of this vertex is plus 1 compared to the 8 of this vertex. With Christian, we prove that this cube complex is a cat zero cube complex. And so I give just the idea of the proof. So the connectness is given by the Zariski theorem we have seen before. So if you look at two vertex, you can look at composing a marking with the inverse of the other one. It gives you a birational transformation. And by the Zariski theorem, you know that you can decompose this map by blowing up and blowing down. And so this gives you the edges, so it gives you a pass between these two vertices. Then for the simply connectness, we can look at a loop. We can homotop it to inside the one skeleton. And we look at the vertices that it passed through, V1 to Vn, and we can assume that these vertices, they don't do this loop doesn't do a back and come back. So we can assume that Vi is not the same as Vi plus 2. And beyond these vertices, we choose one of minimal I. And so it means that the one just before and the one just after, because they are linked by an edge, they have a height plus one of this of the edge of the height of this vertex. And this means that on this vertex, on a representative of on a surface which represents this this vertex v height zero, it exists two distinct points, one which will give a surface which represents v height zero minus one, and one which represents a surface which of v height zero plus one. And so once we have two distinct points on a surface, you have a square, and so you can replace v height zero by v height zero prime. And to be sure that this finished, so now we either make increase the minimal height of the vertices of the loop, or we make decrease the number of vertices having the minimal height. And to make this stop, we can use again the Zariski theorem, and it will be a surface which dominates all the vertices. And when we do this operation to replace v height zero by v height zero prime, the surface will also dominate this one. So in fact, we'll homotop this loop to the vertex where the minimal surface dominating these vertices represents. And the links are flagged by definition of our cube complex almost. Well, we have something to say, but really few. Now, which is nice with this cube, now the Cremona group acts on the cube complex, and it acts just on the marking. And so to P2 identity, if we make it a sigma, then we'll get the vertex P2 sigma. And because it's an involution, this vertex will be sent to this one. So in fact, this cube blue-green will be sent to this cube red-white, and and this point will be fixed. And this point corresponds to this is a vertex where representative is given by S sigma, which is a minimal resolution of sigma, with the marking being the composition of these three blocks. And we have this three squared here, here, and here. Because once you, okay, so this cube corresponds to going to S sigma, this cube corresponds to go by contracting directly to S sigma. But what we can do is that if we cross the wall, the green wall, and then the dark green wall here, it's doing the first blow up, then the second one. And here what happens is that the line which we're going through these two points, it becomes minus one curve, so it's curve of intersection minus one. And these are the curves that you can contract onto a point, and the surface will remain smooth. So once we are here, instead of first bringing up this point, we could have contract the curve yellow to a point, and then bring up the point blue, and we'll arrive here, and then it will remain to just contract orange and red. So, and this is exactly once we are here to go to yellow, contract it, and then we go up. So it means we blow up blue, and then we have two ways to contract orange and red. Now, what is nice with this cube complex is that there is a correspondence between some notions associated to the Cremona group and with some notion of the cube complex. So, for instance, twice the number of base points of a Cremona transformation, it's given by the distance, okay, the combinatorial distance between the vertex P2 identity and the vertex P2F. Also, twice the dynamical number of base points. So this is a notion which has been introduced by Julie Deserti and Jérémy Blanc, and they have studied it. And in fact, twice this number, it's exactly the translation length for the action of F on the K0 cube complex for the combinatorial distance. So it has also a geometrical meaning. And we see immediately that if this translation length is zero, it means that we are the application is elliptic. And we know by construction of for complex that elliptic elements, they are elements which are conjugated to an automorphism of a surface. Okay, because you conjugate by the marking of this surface, your Cremona transformation, and it will give you an automorphism of this surface. And such elements which are conjugated to automorphism of surface, they are important because when you have a birational transformation, okay, there are elements which are not automorphism. But if you are regularizable, it means that you can conjugate them and then they become an automorphism of the surface. So it means that in some sense, their dynamic is still nice. And they prove that regularizable elements are exactly the ones which have a dynamical base points at zero. And for us, it's really almost by definition. Well, once we have proved this, which is easy, we have this immediately. And we did it for any field, while they did for others, even if it could have been improved. But another results we can get, I will go fast on it, but it was that every birational transformation is conjugated to an algebraically stable model. So this is kind of a generalization of the thing. So not any Cremona transformation can be conjugated to an automorphism of a surface, but it can always be conjugated to an element of a subgroup of birational transformation of a surface, where the dynamic of when you compose by himself will be nicer. And so this is a nice notion in dynamic and algebraic geometry. And this is a theorem which has been proved by Charles Favre and Jeffrey Diller. And their proof is a bit involving, and well, for us is really immediate because this stable model will be vertices which lie in the axis of F. So it's immediate that this exists because by a result of Haglund's isometry are semi-simple. So we have no parabolic element. So either it's lobosyndromic and we have an axis, either it's elliptic, but then this surface where you are conjugated to an automorphism is your stable model. Well, is one of your stable models. And another remark is that they did it for C, but probably for algebraically closed field would have worked, and we did it for any field, with the proof really, really straightforward. And another kind of result, I will go fast, next we can have, is that we can find some group which are regularizable. So a group is regularizable now if it can be conjugated to a subgroup of an automorphism of surface. So now we don't look at just one application, but all subgroups. And so subgroup with property FW, it's by definition that it will be regularizable because then it will be elliptic for our action. And being stabilizer means being regularizable. And also the element of uniformly bounded degree. There will be, if a group has an element with uniformly bounded degree, it will be regularizable because we can bound the number of base points by a constant times the degree. And so, and the number of base points give you the distance between a P2 identity and the action of small g on P2 identity. So it will be a bounded orbit, and then we have a fixed point, and because it's oriented, we will have a fixed vertices. So these are results again, which are already known, well, which were already known, but we give a really easy proof, which works over any field, and just with one tool we get several results, and so it kind of unified everything. So it's really a nice object associated to the Cremona. Nevertheless, it stays it stays some open question on the Cremona group of Frank II. And one is the following: that if you have a finitely generated subgroup of the Cremona group, such that each of its elements is regularizable, does it imply that all the group is regularizable? And if we rephrase it in terms of a cube complex, it means that if we have a finitely generated subgroup of the Cremona group such that each of its elements is elliptic, does it imply that all the group is elliptic? And so here we have an algebraic question, and we want to, well, we can rephrase it completely in terms of cube complex. And for instance, when a group acts on a cube complex, which is of finite dimension, k0 cube complex, we know that this result is true, but it's not the case when it's infinite dimensional like it's our case. So we are now trying to see if with the condition of our group we can still have such results, which would be really nice. So if someone has some kind of restriction to group acting on a k0 cube complex of infinite dimension to get this kind of result, please, we are welcome to have some information. And I will finish, before finishing, I will say just that in our article, the second part is of building cube complex for a Cremona group of higher rank. And the construction is not exactly the same, but the idea came back not so far. We just tried to solve the problem we have to when we wanted to generalize it. So thank you for your attention.